Balabha Yadi Vada Dadi. Yasodanandana Prajajanarandana. Yasodanandana Prajajanarandana. Jamunatiravana Chadi. Jamuna Tiravana Chadi. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hadi. Madhava Kunjabi. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hadi. Madhava Kunjabi Hadi. Gopi Jana Balabha Giri Vada Dhadi. Gopi Jana Balabha Giri Vada Dhadi. Yasodanandana Prajajanarandana. Yasodanandana Prajajanarandana. Jamunatiravana Chadi. Jamunatiravana Chadi. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hadi. Madhava Kunjabi. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hadi. Jaya Vishnupad Paramahamsa Hari Vidika Chaudra Jasta Tarasa Tasi Sima Bhakti Vedanta Swami Shira Prabhupati Ananta Koti Vaishnavrinda Ki Shri Radha Shama Sundara Ki Gaur Pemanandi. I'm going to need the remote slide changer. Someone can get the remote slide changer from that control room back there. Remote slide changer, please. The light went on inside. Thank you, thank you. Okay. Well, as it usually happens when we have some discussion on a topic that continues, some of the people that were here aren't present. Some of the persons that weren't here are present. So for those of you that are new to this whole topic, once again, we'll do a little review. We're discussing Tattva Sandarbha of Jiva Goswami. And Tattva Sundarbha is the first of six Sundarbhas. Sundarbha literally means weaving. So verses of Srimad Bhagavatam are woven together in a Sundarbha fashion. It's a classic type of Sanskrit literature called Sundarbha that serves as a commentary on Srimad Bhagavatam by topic. A little history. After Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had taken sannyas at the age of 24, at the request of his mother, he went to Puri. He stayed there for some months, and then he began a two-year tour of South India. One of the places he stayed during the rainy season that year was in Sri Rangam. He stayed at the home of the chief priest of Sri Rangam named Venkata Bhatta. Venkata Bhatta had a young son, 6 years old, named Gopal. Gopal developed a very deep, transcendentally deep affection for Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in the course of those 4 months. He heard from him every day. He served him every day. He received Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's teachings expertly. And after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu left, after those 4 months of the rainy season, he's a little boy, super scholarly. He read Srimad Bhagavatam and kept careful notes. He didn't have a computer. But by the topics within Srimad Bhagavatam, he took his notes. And then later when he went to live in Vrindavan, he gave those notes to Jiva Goswami and requested Jiva Goswami two things. Please take these notes and put them in a form of a book that can be then understood by everybody, a topic-by-topic summary of Srimad Bhagavatam. And the second request is, don't mention my name. So in the Mangala Charana, those first eight verses invoking auspiciousness, he mentions one Bhatta. Bhatta is a term that is generic. It can mean a learned person, like Vipra or Bhatta. One Bhatta, he didn't mention his name, but it's Gopal Bhatta, provided me with his systematic and comprehensive study of Srimad Bhagavatam according to the teachings of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, which he heard for 4 months. And that became the Sundarbhas. So we're studying the first of the Sundarbhas, Tattva Sundarbha. Tattva means truth or categories of knowledge about something, like Jiva Tattva, Shakti Tattva, Vishnu Tattva, Krishna Tattva. This just happens to be Krishna Tattva. Because Krishna is the object, Krishna is the subject of Srimad Bhagavatam. So just a little review for those of you that are joining us. Last Thanksgiving holiday, we discussed the first half of this Tattva Sundarbha, which is after the invoking auspiciousness section, Mangala Charana, there's Pramana Kanda. Pramana means evidence or source of valid knowledge. In the Mangala Charana, Jiva Goswami says, I want to talk about Krishna. Then before I talk about Krishna, we should first responsibly say, what's the best means of knowing about the topic we want to discuss? Krishna. So then he considers different ways that people can get knowledge and concludes the best is descending knowledge coming from God, scripture. Shabda pramana, aparusheya shabda. Aparusheya means beyond the defects of a human being. Parusheya or purusha is us and aparusheya is him. Aparusheya shabda. And of the Vedas, which are aparusheya shabda, the best, without going through the 35 hours of discussion, the best is Srimad Bhagavatam. And he, you know, systematically reaches that conclusion. So this morning, we discussed, what does that aparusheya shabda pramana, what does that best means of knowing about Krishna say? What is the subject of that book, Srimad Bhagavatam? And in order to capture the essence of that book, Srimad Bhagavatam, we heard this morning, Jiva Goswami says, one of the best ways to know what the subject of the book is to know the heart of the speaker, because he's going to speak what's in his heart. That's the message, Srimad Bhagavatam, that he spoke. So what's in his heart will tell you what the message is. And so, little review. Now, just the verses from this morning. 6 verses, 29 through 33. 29 starts with Shukadeva Goswami. In short, Shukadeva Goswami was a fully Brahman-realized person. We heard Krishna came to the place of Vyasadeva's home, his little cottage, where his wife was pregnant with Shukadeva Goswami. He promised Shukadeva that he would not be touched by Maya. He was already Brahman realized before leaving the womb of his mother, but he wouldn't lose it. He would be protected from Maya. It's important. He wasn't in Maya. He's protected by Maya going forward in time. He was filled, sva sukha nibrita chetasa. He was filled with his own happiness within his internal consciousness. He wasn't looking for anything outside for happiness. Full with his own happiness. Then something happened. He heard Srimad Bhagavatam from his father Vyas, and there's details. And that vast sky of Brahman happiness became filled with the greater happiness. Happiness of hearing topics of Krishna, hearing the qualities of Krishna, hearing the pastimes of Krishna, hearing the names of Krishna. Krishna Tattva is the subject that his heart became filled with, and that became the message that he spoke, Srimad Bhagavatam. And then inferred is the process of coming to the stage of perfection is by hearing and rendering devotional service accordingly, and the stage of perfection is ecstatic love for Krishna. That was text 29. So the heart disclosed the subject that he spoke about. His heart, beyond attraction for anything material, was attraction for Krishna, who means he's not material. And it means realization of Krishna is beyond realization of Brahman. Very important. Then 32, 31, 32, 33, we heard two verses of Vyasadeva's realization. Understand the heart of Vyas. So what was Vyas's qualification? besides he's a literary incarnation, the language of the Bhagavatam says, Amala is beyond any material contamination. His heart is like Vyas, as Shukadev, no material tinge in his heart. And he was fixed in samadhi. His mind was fixed in the trance of samadhi. And he was on the stage of prema, bhakti yogena manasi. So that was his qualification, that was his heart. And then what did he see? So we discussed 174 and 175. That's what we covered. So 174, besides what his state of consciousness was, what his heart was, he saw Parama Purusha, or Purna Purusha. He saw the Supreme Person in fullness. And to see the Supreme Person in fullness, Jiva Goswami explains with scriptural references, he saw Krishna in his original feature. Because you can see Krishna as super soul, and that's not his original feature, that's his feature that deals with the material energy and doesn't show pastimes. So that's not Krishna in his fullness. Purna Purusha is Krishna. And when you see Krishna, this is a little ISKCON history. Prabhupada very much liked paintings to illustrate his books. So he created an art department out of nothing. He engaged people that had never held a paintbrush. They liked to do service, so he gave them the opportunity, and they learned by Super Soul's direction. So they didn't know how to paint paintings of Krishna, so they went to import stores and got some posters of Krishna, and then showed posters of Krishna, and the language at the time was, Prabhupada, is this bona fide? And one of the standards of bona fide is Krishna must be with his devotees. Because sometimes there's really beautiful paintings of Krishna's face in a cloud. No devotees. Prabhupada said that's not bona fide. Because Krishna's not alone. Krishna's with his devotees. Where's the river Jamuna? Where's Govardhan Hill? Where's the peacocks? Where's Krishna's flute? Where's Radharani? Where are the cows and the cowherd boys? Where's Nanda and Jasoda? You won't find Krishna without them. So Purna Purusha, he saw the whole spiritual world. It doesn't say he saw the whole spiritual world. He says he saw Purna Purusha. Then in text 31, specifically we heard, Jiva Goswami said, he saw Radharani. Doesn't say he saw Radharani, but like you say, if you see the full moon, you don't say, oh, and by the way, I also saw the effulgence around the full moon. You don't say it. But it's understood you must see the effulgence along with the full moon. So he saw Radharani, he saw the internal potency. Then he saw the external potency. That's explicitly said. It's repeated again and again, and it's going to be repeated again during today's class. Mayam cha tadapashrayam, tadapashrayam. Under his control, or his ashray, he was the shelter of Maya, but she was at a distance. So he goes, Jiva Goswami does this whole explanation. There's a distinction between the external potency and the internal potency. Vyas saw both. And then in the next verse, 175, and then he saw the jiva. And he saw the characteristics of the jiva that says they're simultaneously one with Krishna and different from Krishna. We're going to hear about that this evening. Simultaneously one with and different from. And it's not double talk. So they're both conscious, the jiva, and he cites terms from these verses that say they're conscious. But they're different because one is the controller of Maya and the other is under the control of Maya. So they're distinct entities, not one entity. Then Jiva Goswami starts heading in the direction of what the Mayavadis say. That doesn't match Vyasadeva's realization. And it goes into this discussion in text 30 about upadis. Remember that one? Upadi. I'd mentioned. In ISKCON, we hear this verse because there's two standard definitions of what bhakti is, and one of them has the word upadi. From Narada Pancharatra. Sarva upadi vinir muktam tat paratvena nirmalam rishikena rishikesha sevanam bhaktir uchate. It's a definition of bhakti where upadis are vinir muktam. You get rid of them. So what are upadis that we hear about? Well, I'm American and somebody is Indian and somebody's black and somebody's white, somebody's male, somebody's female, somebody's young, somebody's old, somebody's this and somebody's that. It's the covering, it's not who we are. Not who we are. It's an upadi. It's a covering of who we are. That's how we're used to hearing. But then there's this other idea that the Mayavadis have of upadi. And in text 30, there's this Paramatma. It doesn't show the fullness of Krishna in Goloka because he's accepted voluntarily, he's not conditioned by, like we are, the coverings of the soul. But Krishna accepts this limitation. He doesn't show his fullness because he deals with the material energy and directs the affairs of the material energy to give the living entities their karma, their desire and their deserve. Guna karma vibhagasha. The Mayavadis take this term upadi and twist it and turn it around and make it something that it wasn't intended to be. And so what we discussed at the beginning of this section is listen carefully to these verses 29 through 33, because starting this evening, 34, 35, and 36, I adjusted the schedule a little bit, we'll cover three verses. Taking the tools of Vyasa's realization, Jiva Goswami is then going to take a look at what those who say they're followers of Vyasadeva, specifically Shankaracharya, what he says that's different than what Vyasadeva's realization was. It's really clear. Now, one could, I don't know, you could give a two-semester course on the distinction between Mayavad philosophy and Vaishnava philosophy and still not cover the whole subject. So we're not going to attempt to do anything like that. It's just going to be really simple. But Jiva Goswami hits on, you know, the nerve. You know, like a dentist will. He hits the nerve of the fallacy, that the foolishness of that which a lot of people believe in. I mean, let's show hands. How many have heard the phrase, it's all one? We've all heard it. We've all heard it. It's all one. In the final analysis, Swamiji, it's all one. Oh, Prabhupada, hit the ceiling. People say that without all the anecdotal. It's a common thing. If you're going to be spiritual, then you don't like take sides with anything. In the final analysis, it's all one. That's Shankara's teaching. There's only one thing. Brahman. And everything else doesn't even exist. It's false. Brahman satya, jagat mithya. Yeah? Brahman is reality, and everything else is false. Mithya. Anything else. And you name it, and it's false. It just doesn't exist. There's only one thing. That's not Vyasa's realization. And point by point, he's going to go through that subject. Not exhaustively, but simply. Okay, so now. This is the broad section, verse 29 through 49. We discussed just now texts 29 through 33, and now we're entering into a new section, and that is with Jiva Goswami's defeating Mayavad philosophy and establishing Lord Chaitanya's philosophy, which is Achintya Bheda, Abheda, Tattva. Bheda means different, and abheda means not different. Sounds like double talk. Everything that exists has a relationship with its source of emanation, Krishna, and everything that comes from Krishna has a relationship with him that is simultaneously one with him and different from him. Simultaneously one with him and different from him. So Jiva Goswami is going to show that's Vyasa's realization, which is then in turn the message of Srimad Bhagavatam, which is then in turn the teachings of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. That's what Srimad Bhagavatam reveals. And it's based on just these two verses, texts 4 and 5 from chapter 7, canto 1. And it's all in the category of this sambandha. Tattva, the relationship of the living entity with Krishna, his external potency, his internal potency, and we're going to hear some more things. Time. So we're going to be discussing 34, 35, 36, and then tomorrow we'll finish the other ones up to 43. Now, the realizations of Vyasa have major implications, specifically in refutation of Shankaracharya's very popular monistic philosophy, even though, we said it this morning, I'll repeat it, Shankaracharya accepts the authority of Vyasadeva. So historically, after Kali Yuga began, everything began to deteriorate, and it's still deteriorating. My goodness, the world is deteriorating. And one of the things that was deteriorating is that people were taking improper advantage of the Vedas and slaughtering animals in the name of the Vedas, say it's okay. Buddha came along as an incarnation of Krishna, saw this slaughtering of animals and said, if it's authorized by the Vedas, then I reject the Vedas. Now, follow what I say, be nonviolent, which is in the Vedas. But people were misusing it, so rather than just having them correct the misuse, he rejected the Vedas. And being an incarnation of Krishna, he was very powerful. He was born or made his appearance in India. And India, which was Vedic, became very strongly, powerfully influenced by Buddha. And that was several hundred years before Christ. Then some 700, 800 years after Christ came Shankara, who rejected Buddha. and reestablished the Vedas, which means he accepted Vyas, but he taught something different than what Vyas realized and wrote. So that's what we're going to hear Jiva Goswami expose. He who accepts Vyas says something other than what Vyas says. That's not okay. So the Achintya Beda Abheda Tattva philosophy is being presented, where the Lord is like the jivas in that they're both spiritual, yet the jivas and the Lord are different. So this text summarizes this teaching, difference and non-difference simultaneously, not only between Krishna and the living entities, but Krishna and everything, because everything comes from him. But we're going to focus on the living entities. So here's Baladev Vidyabhusan in his very articulate way commenting. In 174, one of the things that Vyas saw was Mayam Cha Tadapashrayam. He saw the material energy was under Krishna's shelter. So in relation between the Supreme Lord and Maya, the Supreme Lord is the Lord of Maya. Then he, in the next verse, he saw the living entities, where the living entities, yaya samohito jiva, the living entities become bewildered by and controlled by Maya. Well, hey, there's a difference. They're both conscious beings, that's the sameness, but the difference is the Krishna's in control of Maya and Maya controls the living entity. So there's a difference right within his realization. And as is part of the methodology of Jiva Goswami, he makes his statements and then he supports his statements with scripture. So the scriptural support that he gives here is from, down here. Nityo Nityanam Chaitanas Chaitananam. Prabhupada would quote this hundreds and hundreds of times from the Upanishads, a very authentic reference where that amongst conscious living beings, there's one supremely conscious living being. Amongst eternals, there's one supreme eternal. Eko bahunam yo vidadati kama, that one, the supreme, is maintaining all the others. There's a difference between the living entity and the supreme. Then Jiva Goswami goes on, Vishwanath goes on, using, how many have read Bhagavad Gita? Maybe do it the other way. Has anybody here not read Bhagavad Gita? And if in the introduction to Bhagavad Gita, Prabhupada refers to Baladev Vidyabhusan because he's the primary commentator that Prabhupada's commentary follows. He says, as he said about everything within the Vedas, including here, there are five subject matters in Bhagavad Gita. One of them is temporary, the other four are eternal. That makes five. The four, the living entity, time, the Supreme Lord, Ishvara, and material nature, Prakriti. And then the one that's temporary is karma, that moves with time. Although time is eternal, it has features of past, present, and future, and that moves karma, the temporary one. So he says, Vishwanath says, four of the five were seen by Vyas in his realization. And they were eternal, existing even before material creation. Here's how he presents it. Both Ishvara and the Jiva eternally exist with the quality of consciousness we heard before. The living entity, this from this morning, The living entity is both conscious and consciousness, just like a lamp is effulgent and illuminates other things. The soul is conscious and consciousness. It's conscious of things. So both the living entity and the supreme were seen by Vyas. And he also saw matter, or Maya, affected by the three modes. And he also saw time. Now, it doesn't specifically say that he saw time, but it's inferred. Vishwanath says, or excuse me, Baladev Vidyavasan says, implied is that Vyas also saw the time energy indicated by verbs that require time. He saw, he was bewildered, he considered. These verbs indicate action, which requires time. In order to really see something, it takes a little bit of time. In order to become bewildered, it takes a little bit of time, etc. So it's implied. He saw these four. Now, there's Shankaracharya, and he says something else besides what Vyas saw. And what is that something else? He says there's only one thing, Brahman. And that's the one supreme truth beyond all differentiation, and that's the only thing that's real, that's the only tattva, is Brahman. And there isn't anything else. Jiva Goswami, in his commentary on Tattva Sandarbha, comments, this is very unreasonable. And we'll go into it in some detail. That there's this Brahman entity that's pure spiritual. It has the power to maintain Maya and is full of perfect knowledge, and yet it becomes an object of the influence of Maya and is overcome by ignorance. That's what he teaches. We'll see. Stay tuned. He said it's very unreasonable. Rather, as Maya acts differently on the living entity and is under the control of God, we can understand they're two different entities with separate capabilities. That's how we should understand. So now, get ready for some poison. Because following Jiva Goswami, we're going to lay out Mayavad doctrine. We're not trying to indoctrinate you to Mayavad doctrine. But he wants to show how silly it is. Because when you hear, well, it's all one. Sounds cool. I'll just a little sharing. When I was in college, it was the first time I came in contact with chanting Hare Krishna. I didn't know the devotees. I didn't know the Hare Krishna movement. I didn't know Bhagavad Gita. I didn't know nothing. And there was this fellow, won't mention his name, he was doing the college circuit teaching kirtan. And so I went. I was attracted to kirtan. I didn't know what it was, but it was. Then his message was, become one with the chant. I said, wow, that sounds cool. What does that mean, become one with the chant? So I went, kept going to the different places where he was teaching, and then he explained it a little bit more. He said, in the beginning, there's you in the chant, but you keep going, and it's no longer you in the chant, it's just the chant. And I realized what he was saying. He's saying, you become God. You become Krishna. I said, forget this guy. Poor Krishna. It was a Mayavadi. I didn't know what a Mayavadi was, but I met one. And I don't know, just on a gut level, I thought, this is ridiculous. I didn't understand Tattvasandarbha. I didn't understand chapter 7 of Adi Lila, where Lord Chaitanya refutes Mayavad doctrine. It's just in the gut level. Forget it. You become God. Become one with the Supreme. Because in the final analysis, it's all one. So you're going to get how they got there. This is Shankara's poison, his teachings. We won't spend too much time on it, don't worry. Okay, so here's where it starts. There's only one thing that exists. And what's that one thing? It's Brahman. And by definition, Brahman is knowledge, jnana. And in opposition to illusion, there's no illusion where there's knowledge. Now, how to explain variety in the material world? There's variety. Well, here's what Shankara says. This is only apparent, this duality in this material world is only apparent because this idea of God and the living entities and the varieties of matter, it's only an illusion. And this illusion is one of the upadis that gets imposed on Brahman. Now listen carefully, it's really clever. Since Brahman is all that exists, this ajnana that covers Brahman, it neither exists nor doesn't exist. Whoa. It's anirvachaniya. Vacha means to speak. Anirvachaniya is something, it's inexplicable. It doesn't exist, and it does exist, and it's neither it does exist or doesn't exist. It's neither one of those. Huh? So don't ask where does this ajnana come from, because it doesn't exist. But it does exist. It's cheating. Okay, so then this ajnana or maya or illusion, it divides itself into two, knowledge and ignorance. Wow. And then what happens? Well, then there's this vidya or the knowledge as an upadi. It superimposes itself on the whole of Brahman, and that becomes God. And then there's some other small parts of Brahman that become covered by avidya, and that becomes the jiva. But really, there's only one thing, and that's Brahman, or knowledge. But then here comes this avidya thing, and the avidya breaks into two parts. Excuse me, ajnana breaks into two parts. Wow, it's really complicated, but it's not over yet. Here's how you get out of being under illusion. God, who is a product of Brahman covered by knowledge or vidya, he's good. He always thinks and acts perfectly, even though he's unreal. And the living entities, they're covered by avidya or ignorance, and they cannot be perfect as long as they can continue to consider themselves as existing separately. But the good news is, by vidya, you can overcome avidya and become one with the Supreme. That's it in a nutshell. Yummy, huh? Now, if it doesn't make sense to you, that's good, because it doesn't make sense. And if it made sense to you, that would be not so good, because then maybe you're a Mayavadi. But, you know, item by item, so in this list, I'll just, you know, there's five upadis that cover the one thing that is real truth, and that's Brahman, and then you get stuff. You get the material creation, where there's God, there's the living entities, there's knowledge, there's ignorance, and there's illusion. Those are all upadis that cover Brahman, and the program is to get free from upadis so you become one with Brahman. That's Shankara's teachings. Now, in text 30, we had this little discussion about upadis, and now we're going to have it again, because they're using it in a different way. It's a Sanskrit term. It's a valid Sanskrit term. And there's the proper application, and there's a twisted, contorted misapplication of the term. So upadi means this limiting or restricting factor, something that apparently limits or defines an object. Remember, Jiva Goswami used this example of a translucent crystal. You put a red rose next to the translucent crystal, it may look red. May even look like there's a rose inside the crystal. That you think crystals are, it's this shaped thing with a rose inside. But the redness or the rose feature is an upadi of a translucent crystal that apparently limits or restricts. That's what the term means. Now, according to the Mayavad doctrine, there is no such thing as God. There is no such thing as a living entity. They don't exist. They're not intrinsic. They're not eternal. That's not what Vyas saw, but that's what Shankara says. That's only upadis that superimpose on Brahman. Just get rid of the upadis and you're good. You're Brahman. And then so there's this vidya factor that superimposes on Brahman, and that's God. And there's avidya that superimposes on a small part of Brahman, and that's the living entity. They're really stretching it. So what's the solution? Spiritual knowledge. Study Vedanta Sutra. Get knowledge. And then with knowledge, you can become restored to your position of being the unlimited, non-variegated Brahman. You become God. Or become one with the chant. And there's, even amongst Mayavadis, it's not all one. There are different varieties of Mayavadis. And one of those varieties of Mayavadis likes this example of a pot. It's a metaphor. A pot encloses part of the sky. You break the pot, and the sky that was within the pot and the unlimited sky outside the pot become indistinguishable. And in fact, even before the pot is broken, they're indistinguishable. It's just an artificial distinction of the sky that's in the pot and the sky that's outside the pot. That's their metaphor. So similarly, all you have to do is get rid of your upadis, and after all, they're not real anyways. They're just an imposition of illusion on Brahman. And you become Brahman realized. You become God. That's the program. Now, in text 35, we've gone 34, now we're into 35, and we're going to finish with 36. So Jiva Goswami spends a little bit of time, and he's going to go further later. refuting these unintelligible ideas. First of all, according to the realization of Vyas and according to the statements of the Vedas, the Supreme is never bewildered by illusion. His realization is the living entities become bewildered by Maya. And to say, second argument, to say that illusion becomes forced upon or superimposed upon the Supreme is contradictory and not at all reasonable, but totally ridiculous or absurd is to simultaneously say that part of Brahman becomes influenced by Vidya and another part by Avidya. This Supreme is both influenced by Vidya and Avidya. It's like, please stop. Then according to the realization of Vyas, Maya being an inferior expansion of the personal energy of the Supreme is subordinate to the Supreme. That's what his realization saw. We also heard she cannot even stand in the presence of the Supreme, what to speak of making him an object of her control by transforming him into the whole world of illusion. That was Vyasa's realization. And later also, Shukadev Goswami says the same thing in Canto 2. And then finally, Vyas saw the living entity as existing on his own right. He doesn't have to come into being by being covered by some upadi or something like that. Before liberation and after liberation, the living entity is his own entity. Vyasa's realization refutes the mumbo jumbo of Shankaracharya. And we're very grateful to our founder Acharya because in our prayer, our pranam mantra unto him, Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pastya Cha Desha Tarine. He's the deliverer of the Western countries which are filled with impersonalism and voidism. It's not some remote part of South India. Sringeri Mathan, they have some impersonalisms over there. And maybe there's some over in Varanasi also. The whole Western world is filled with impersonalism and voidism. I remember very clearly Prabhupada speaking about impersonalists, and I was wondering, what's that? I just, you know, didn't understand what it meant. And then he was translating Chaitanya Charitamrita. When it came to Adi Lila chapter 7, he had it published as a separate book. That's Lord Chaitanya's discussion with Prakashananda Saraswati. It was in a paperback, it was in a hardcover, and he wanted us to read it. He wanted us to understand this discussion that we're having on why impersonal ideas are not substantial. That was what Prabhupada saw his mission. Where did we get Prabhupada's pranam mantra? At that time, nobody knew Sanskrit. Prabhupada wrote it himself. Nirvishesha Shunyavadi. That was his dedication, as we can see very clearly. It's the dedication of Jiva Goswami. And where did Jiva Goswami get it? From Rupa Goswami and Lord Chaitanya and Srimad Bhagavatam. So, you know, the going is a little tough at times, but it's important. As we said, there's major implications from this realization of Vyas. And this is an illustration of Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami. Do you know who is Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami? He's the author of Chaitanya Charitamrita, which Prabhupada also translated from Bengali to English. And in that Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is some discussion of something that's complicated, very intricate, and this seems to contradict that, seems to contradict that, seems to contradict that. And he just lays it all out. It has to do with ways of viewing aspects of Bhagavan. Some say this, some say that. And then he writes, a sincere student should not neglect the discussion of such conclusions, considering them controversial, for such discussions strengthen the mind. Thus, one's mind becomes attached to Sri Krishna. So please pardon me as we go through these tedious discussions on Shankaracharya's teachings. My God, who cares anyways? Because we're strongly influenced by it. We may not recognize it, but devotees, we're strongly influenced by it. The Western countries are filled with impersonalism and voidism, and we're influenced by it. There's the reference. Chaitanya Charitamrita, Adi Lila, chapter 2, where Krishna Das writes this. So now we're concluding with text 36 for this evening, where Jiva Goswami goes on the positive and says, there is a difference between the living entity and God. It's not that there's just some upadhi difference between the two and all there is Brahman. Rather, he says, the jiva is not merely an upadhi, nor is Vishnu a Purusha merely an upadhi, nor is the difference between them merely an upadhi. Shame on you, Shankaracharya, for making such false statements that are not at all in keeping with Vyasa's realization. Remember who is Jiva Goswami's audience. Just like when you're speaking, or when you're writing, or when you're interacting, you need to know your audience. Let's say, you know, an elementary school teacher. She has to speak according to the capacity of the students to understand her, or him. And you're speaking to, you know, some college students, and to, you know, you speak with different language, and you're speaking with graduate students, you're speaking with postgraduate, you're speaking to PhDs, you're speaking to highly scholarly people. You speak differently. One of the things they appreciate about Sariputta Prabhu is he was able to speak in such abstract terms, at the same time then explain it to everybody else that doesn't know all these terminologies. He knew his audience and was able to touch his audience. So Jiva Goswami is speaking to this very scholarly group of people, highly sophisticated in their study of the Vedas and their understanding of this and that. So he's now going to go into metaphysics. Every time I hear this language in the past, it just kind of like my brain just shuts off. I'm not interested. Metaphysics. Metaphysics sounds like gobbledygook to me, metaphysics. But it means something to some people, to these scholarly people. It's a philosophical study of being and knowing. Boy, get abstract. So there's a metaphysics of Shankaracharya's teachings. And it starts with a given. There's only one thing, Brahman. And that Brahman is perfect and unchanging. That's the study of being and knowing. So then let's ask this question of Shankara. If that's the case, then how do you account for diversity in this world, where there's things that are imperfect and changing all the time? How do you explain that, Shankaracharya Prabhu? Well, here's Shankaracharya's answer. There's some other entity, something that doesn't exist or doesn't not exist. And somehow that gets imposed on the one thing that does exist. Really? How'd that happen? Vaishnava acharyas object and say, please, this ajnana thing, it either exists or it doesn't exist. And if it does exist, then you can't say there's only one thing, because then there's two things. And if it doesn't exist, then it doesn't exist. You can't get this imperfect world if it doesn't exist. Metaphysics of Shankaracharya. So, he's in a bind, in one sense, because he has accepted the Vedas, which means he's accepted Vyas. So, and the Vedas say certain things, like, you know, the Purusha Sukta prayers from the Rig Veda, they speak about creation. The Shruti mantras speak about creation. That means there's a creator, and there's that which he creates. There's this world of duality that he creates, and it's described in the Upanishads and in the Rig Veda mantras. And not only that, there's this relationship with he who creates, with the living entities who he creates for. Now, how do you deal with all that? Well, even before how you deal with all that, we ask Shankara, could you please explain how it happens, this thing that neither exists or doesn't exist, how it gets to the position of covering Brahman? Could you go over that one, please? And sure, I'll go over that one. There's different ways to look at it. And he takes terms that come directly from the Vedas, paricheda and pratibimba. So please don't get worried about more terminology. It's pretty simple. Here's what they look like in a chart. So pratiched is like this pot example. You know, the sky being enclosed by a pot. So delimiting is the language that Gopi has used. There's this upadi thing that delimits, you know, like the red rose next to a translucent crystal. Or even here's something really, really simple. A body of water, a lake or a pond that covers some part of the land. So there's land, and there's the bottom of the lake that's also land or earth. And then there's this lake or pond that covers some part of the land. So the lake or the pond delimits or covers the earth. So that has its appropriate application. Here's another one. You know, the boundary of a country, or, you know, the city limits. You know, we're in, what's the town we're in? What's the town here? Plainfield? Plainfield? South Plainfield. So there's some city limit, or like your house, if you have one. Then, you know, there's the property line, and on this side is ours, and on that side is not ours. So this delimits. It's an imposition on everything. It's actually Krishna's, but, you know, this is mine and that's his. It's an upadi. It limits, apparently, appears to limit something. So they Shankara says, once upon a time, there's Brahman, and along comes this avidya. And avidya superimposes itself in little tiny units, this upadi superimposes itself in little tiny units on parts of Brahman, and you get living entities. But actually, it's just Brahman with some upadi superimposing on it. And all you have to do is remove the superimposition, you got Brahman again. Because actually, all it is Brahman anyways. That's one of their, that's how did, this answering the question, how did it happen? It doesn't answer the question, how did it happen? Because where's the avidya come from? Or ajnana come from? Or what? Then you got, so, and how did it get, how does that which is perfect and pure become covered by anything? But you know, that's their explanation. That's one of the three. Parichade, or delimiting, the pot example. Then the next one is reflection. It's another interesting one. Pratibimba vad. Jiva Goswami says it's intended to explain within the reflection of something, it shows the qualities of the something that reflects it, or that's a reflection of. Like, here's an apple, here's a mirror, and you look in the mirror and you see the reflection of the apple that looks like the apple. So this looks like reality, but it's not reality. Reality is Brahman. So how does it get distorted into looking like something other than Brahman? It's just an upadi. It's just a reflection of the real thing. That has problems. We'll hear Jiva Goswami refute them. Ishwara and Jivas are real because actually it's just Brahman. They only appear to be different because of the upadis that are reflecting upon Brahman. It's mumbo jumbo, but that's what they say. Then there's a third. This is the one that I was used to hearing growing up in the Hare Krishna movement. And that's this Vivarta Vad. Vivarta Vad means Brahman, Satya, Jag, and Mithya. This, the appearance of variegatedness of bodies and stuff just doesn't exist. It's just a, like a dream. Row, row, row your boat. Gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream. And there's only one thing that's not a dream, and that's Brahman. Just wake up. The dream's over, and you realize you're Brahman. That's it. You're God. We'll see this list again tomorrow morning. But Jiva Goswami in text 36 makes a preliminary pass on the inconsistencies of these theories. First of all, if the absolute is axiomatically immutable and formless, how can it be either divided or reflected? Answer, it can't. Unless you want to change the definition. But you know, the sleight of hand that he does is, he says, well, this illusion neither exists nor doesn't exist. Come on. Give me a break. It either exists or doesn't exist. And where did it come from, this thing that neither exists nor doesn't exist? Well, don't ask that question. It just happened. But it's not, it's inconsistent. Ultimately, it's inconsistent with the realization of Vyas and Shukadev. Then, Jiva Goswami says, if its divisions or reflections are somehow real, despite it can't happen. It's just for argument's sake, it somehow happens. How can the material illusion generated from division or reflection be dispelled merely by abstract thinking, if it's real? The upadis are real. Just by changing your way of thinking, they go away? We'll hear more about this tomorrow. And then, most strongly, Vyasadeva's realization in trance contradicts both of these ideas, Pratibimba and Parichet. Why? Because Vyas saw the living entity, and he saw Paramapurusha, or Purna Purusha. And Shankaracharya is subservient to Vyas. So, again, shame on him. And the name of Vyas, he's saying what Vyas doesn't say. Shame on him. The emperor has no clothes. You know the story. Prabhupada told the story. The king wanted some special clothing. So there was a very clever fellow who was a maker of clothing, whatever you call those people that make clothing. And he said, I can make you a very, very special set of clothing. So unique. No one has ever seen this before. So what he did was he gave the king a set of clothes that wasn't a set of clothes. It was nothing. And the king went around in public seeing my new set of clothes, and everyone was saying, oh, the king has such a nice set of clothes. But one little boy said, why is the king going around not wearing any clothes? The emperor has no clothes. So when you say something that not everybody is agreeing with, it may not be popular, but you have to say the truth, and Jiva Goswami is speaking the truth, that if you're a follower of Vyas, you can't say something other than what Vyas says. So what has been done is he's gone to the Vedanta Sutras and some portions of the Upanishads and twisted it around and said, this is what Vyas says, or this is the truth of the Vedas. For us, remember what we're doing. Let's step back, because we're done for the evening class. What we're doing here is, this is the Pramaya Khanda section of Tattva Sandarbha. We've accepted, guided by Jiva Goswami, we've accepted that Srimad Bhagavatam is the best means of knowing something, certainly the best means of knowing Krishna, best means of knowing anything, the best source of valid knowledge for transcendence. Now, what does that best source say? Well, you can understand what it says by the realization of Sukadeva and Vyas, because what's in their heart is what they say, what comes out, the speaker and the author. So what's the heart of Vyas? That is the standard, the gold standard of understanding whatever is in the Vedas, how it should be, you know, the lens through which you should see it. And if it doesn't match the heart of Vyas or this realization of Vyas, then it's to be rejected. Not only is it illogical and inconsistent and mumbo jumbo, it's to be rejected on scriptural authority and specifically, again, the realization of Vyas and Shukadeva Goswami. What is Krishna Tattva? What's the truth that the Bhagavatam is revealing? This highest authority. So to be continued, he gets invigorated, Jiva Goswami, discussing nonsense and saying why it's nonsense, not just because he doesn't agree with it. Vyas doesn't agree with it. And common sense doesn't agree with it either. It's quite illogical. To be continued. I find it especially interesting how Jiva Goswami deals with Buddhism. Because apparently, at the time of Jiva Goswami, although Buddhism wasn't really strong, there was some strains of Buddhism that were prevalent and, you know, caught the attention of intellectual people. And so he addresses it on the strength of the realization of Vyasa in Shukadeva Goswami and statements from the Bhagavatam. It's really nice. It's really nice, especially because I visit China and I don't know so much about, you know, the views of the people of China until I start visiting and spending time with them. And there's this kind of blind acceptance of Buddhism without even really knowing what Buddhism is. Just like Prabhupada was laughing during one morning walk. The devotees were saying, how you dealt with Dainapan when it came to the publishing of Krishna book. It was really amazing. They made an arrangement. This is a big company in Japan. They made an arrangement that they never had made before. They allowed, without the author giving a substantial bunch of money up front to print the book at their expense. Publishing houses don't do that. They don't take risks. But they did something they'd never done before. And the devotees were saying, Prabhupada, what you did was just amazing. And then Prabhupada replied by saying, the head of the whole company, when he told me he was a Buddhist, and I asked him if he was vegetarian, he said, no. He said, what kind of Buddhist are you? And Prabhupada laughed, and he smiled. And every time we go back, the devotees were saying, every time we go back to deal with the Dainapan and printing, they always ask, how is Swamiji? How is he doing? Prabhupada was so powerful. The emperor has no clothes. So what's behind what Buddhists say? You know, the impersonalist is, it's all one, and the Buddhist is be in the moment. What's real? There's nothing real. Just your moment-to-moment experience, and it's which is ever-changing. And the things that are ever-changing, they aren't real, so all that's real is the moment. Until you get to the higher realization where there's nothing. So does that match what Vyasa says or realized? And what the Bhagavatam teaches? Stay tuned. It's foundational. This message that Jiva Goswami is establishing in this section of Tattva Sandarbha will help you as you go forward in time and interact with people that have different views than, you know, the Hare Krishna movement views. What's the Bhagavatam say? Jiva Goswami will hold you by the hand and take you through step by step so you can understand why we take to devotional service the way that we take to devotional service. Why is it the highest teaching? Not just a sentiment. Oh, it's the highest teaching. On what basis can we have that conviction? It's very valuable. And I'll just end this. It takes a while for it to sink in. That's my experience. I'm sure for you, like many of these things, maybe some lights flash here and there, but a lot of it is like, wow, this is too much. Despite hearing it again and hearing it again, like anything, it's not an imposition upon the mind, it's awakening of the consciousness of the soul so that we can properly discriminate who we are, who Krishna is, and our relationship with him, and not be confused by other ideas. And when somebody says some other idea, we're not confused by that something that somebody says. You don't necessarily have to say, I challenge you, you're nonsense. But in our heart of hearts, there should be a scriptural foundation for why, what our convictions are, what they are. And if the person is the right person, you can share with that right person why this is the correct conviction to hold. Then your mind is clear, just like Krishna Das Kaviraj says. Your mind can then be fixed on Krishna, even when there's something that may initially not be so clear. Stay with it. Hear that sound vibration, try to make sense of it as best you can. And gradually, gradually, the clarity will come. Prabhupada likens it to the rising of the sun in the morning. It's dark. We're in the darkness of ignorance. Om Ajnana Timirandasya. But with knowledge, gradually the light, like the rising of the sun, illumines the darkness. And then you can see things that you couldn't see before because of the light. It's very nice. Spiritual sound vibration is very nice. Just stay with it. Try to understand, listen very carefully. Don't be intimidated by things that you don't understand and go to sleep. Stay with it, try to understand it. And gradually, gradually, it becomes clear. It's 9 o'clock, 5 minutes to nine. A question or two? Yes? What? I can't follow what you said. Can you follow what he said?
Where is Parinamavada and Vivartavada discussed? Parinamavada, Vivartavada?
Parinamavada. Okay.
Where is it discussed? Where is it discussed?
By our acharyas, Shakti Parinamavada, that topic, that's what you're asking? Is this the teaching of Vyas? So you want to know where you can read more about it? That's what your question is?
Yes. I mean, I want to understand better.
Right off the top of my head, I can't answer that question. I'd have to do a little research, and then I can tell you where you can look.
Okay, next question. Could you speak more on why do you say Western world is filled with impersonalism?
Why do I say what?
Western world is filled with impersonalism. Like, do they have Advaita concept in Muslim or Christianity?
I can't follow what you're saying. Speak slowly.
Why do you say Western world is filled with
Why do I say what? Western world.
Is filled with impersonalism.
And Prabhupada wrote his prana mantra. I don't know why you put Western world. Because Bhaktisiddhanta sent him to the Western world. English-speaking parts of the world. Maybe that's why. But it's not that the Western world only. But that was where he was sent. That's my intuitive understanding. I didn't ask Prabhupada why you say Western world. It's just, okay.
Is Christianity and Islam really impersonal?
Well, in its essence, no. But in its practice, yes. In its essence, no. I have had lots of experience distributing books. And when you show somebody a picture of Krishna from the Western world, they say, who is that? That's Krishna. Who's Krishna? He's God. No. He can't look like that. Why he can't look like that? Well, he can't look like that. That's why he can't look like that. No, God is a person who they pray to, but when there's form, activities, etc. No. Person, but not a person. A person, but not a person. Well, so what kind of a person is that? A Holy Spirit. What's that? Ask them sometimes. I've done it. It's very interesting, the variety of things that you hear. So it's not a clear, it's not a clear idea of what person is. Commonly, when you receive those handout things, they call them tracts, Christian tracts, and they show pictures of God. It either looks like Abraham Lincoln sitting on a big, you know, high chair, like, you know, judging people, or some old guy with a long beard in his face in a cloud. And that's God. So almighty, all majesty, all powerful, those are personal characteristics. But when it comes down to connecting those personal characteristics with a person, it's really vague. It's personalism that's impersonal. It's not clear personalism, at best. Now, let's say, for those who have gone very, very deeply into their tradition, then very likely they have a sense of a relationship with a person, that God hears their prayers and answers their prayers, and they have a personal relationship with a person. But, you know, as soon as it comes to form, you know, quality is okay, but form, pastimes, abode, kingdom of God, it gets really vague. That's my experience anyways.
So when we talk to...
Could we give the microphone to somebody else? Because you have... We'll be here all evening.
Krishna Maharaj.
Yeah.
In one of the slides, you presented that the time which is devoid of the modes of nature gives a perception of change.
Time is not influenced by the modes of nature. Okay, the two was in one paragraph. Maya, or Prakriti, is influenced, is made up of the three modes of nature. Time is not, but it gives the sense of past, present, and future.
Okay. Another question I have is, in the Mayavad philosophy presentation, we define Brahman as knowledge, and then we said that our Shankaracharya's philosophy is saying that the agyan, which is ignorance by definition, it has got also knowledge component, the vidya and avidya.
We'll hear it again, but I'll say it slowly because it's mumbo jumbo. So once upon a time, there's only one thing. Actually, there's always only one thing. That's Brahman. But this thing that exists, that neither exists nor doesn't exist, or ignorance, because Brahman is knowledge, ignorance starts to cover Brahman. And ignorance has two parts, illusion. It has two parts, knowledge and ignorance. So knowledge, when knowledge covers Brahman, that becomes God. When ignorance covers parts of Brahman, it becomes a living entity. I mean, it's just their system of mumbo jumbo. So now, what is it that you wanted to know?
I'm having a hard time understanding how...
How many what?
I'm having a hard time understanding how vidya, which is knowledge, could be a component of...
Very good.
Agyan, which is ignorance.
Very good. You're right. It's very unreasonable, very unintelligible. Stay tuned. Jiva Goswami is going to go at it some more. Okay. It's just take, I mean, as far as I can see, you know, in simple terms, it's taking language that's there in the Vedas, putting it together in a package that allows the author, Shankara, and his followers, who gave their lifetime putting the mumbo-jumbo puzzle parts together and saying this means that. So it's taking terminology from the Vedas and putting the puzzle parts together in such a way that you get the construct of diversity that doesn't exist. Because all there is one thing with no diversity. So taking terminology from the Vedas and putting it together in puzzle parts. They really don't fit. So if it doesn't make sense to you, that's good. Because it doesn't make sense. But it's what they say. I'm just taking what they say. There's lots of things, like where does the illusion come from? If it doesn't exist, then your explanation has no meaning, and if it does exist, then you have more than one thing. Very silly. Okay. We'll end there. Thank you very much. Oh, we're going to end. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.